An intellectual carrot. The mind boggles.
You see? You see? Your stupid minds. Stupid! Stupid!
Earth has had Santa Claus long enough. We will bring him to Mars.
I've been afraid a lot of times in my life. But I didn't know the real meaning of fear until... until I had kissed Becky.
One thing will be clear. It's not for man to interfere in the ways of God.
It's alive. Oh, it's alive. It's alive. It's alive.
Everybody, and welcome to Earth versus Soup, episode 196. I'm Aaron Pollier.
And I'm Darlene.
We watched a Hammer film today, but it's not what you think. It's not horror. It's actually one of their earliest movies, and it's called Spaceways from 1953. It was not well received at the time, as far as I know. It kind of bombed out in the theater, and it's difficult to find today. Now, we did find a free version on YouTube. It might be there when you do hear this review. It might not be. I can't tell you.
It was there for 2 years.
What was there for 2 years?
It said 2 years ago.
Oh, that the video was posted?
Yeah, but it's not a clean one. It has some...
There's blurriness to it. So I'm not... Again, we're not holding that against the movie because... It's not the movie's fault that the transfer was
right.
Poor.
It's
right?
76 minutes. In the U.S., it came out on June 24th of 1953. In the U.K., on the 7th of August 1953. That's been kind of strange. I've been seeing the Hammer films get put out in the U.S. before...
The UK?
Before the UK, and it's made in the UK.
Well, it's just how it's distributed, I guess. So, this was filmed at the proper, like, Hammer movie studios, you know, Bray Studios. This is directed by Terrence Fisher, who is incredibly famous in other Hammer films. Like, he directed most of the big Hammer films. There's a lot of talent on and off the screen on this. Which is why this movie seems odd, because it's a very laid back, sedate, almost murder mystery.
Yeah, it's a murder mystery.
It's not.
It just has a science fiction.
There's a science fiction setting to it. Now, I have said in the past that the best science fiction isn't just pure science fiction. Science fiction is. It has another genre attached to it. Horror, mystery, you know, romance, whatever, action. You can have great science fiction that's just really hard
sci-fi. I guess this one has romance too, don't it?
There's romance and it's a mystery. But I don't think it was meant to be science fiction. It feels like the movie... was written as a murder mystery first, and then they retooled it into having science fiction elements to it.
Well, that, it being, gave them a...
that being said, there was some good science fiction stuff in it for 1953.
It gave them a closed environment, though.
Yes. Yeah, it did. It did.
That is one of the things I think they needed, and that's why they took it to this.
So let's talk about the actors first before we go into the plot, and then people will kind of know what we're talking about, at least. Now, I was worried that this might be a short review because I actually have only like a page and a quarter of notes. Usually I have around two and a half, but I think there's a lot of things that we'll talk about as asides in each one of these scenes. The two main actors are Howard Duff, who plays Dr. Mitchell. You may know him from many movies. He was in a lot. And then Eva Bartok plays Dr. Frank. Now, Eva is a Hungarian actress who was Jewish, survived World War II by marrying a Nazi officer to hide. Good for her that she was able to do that.
She's one of those I would call very handsome.
She's a striking woman. striking is how I would describe
it's not it. Like the person that's playing Mrs. Mitchell, which is beauty queen.
No, I wouldn't even call her that. She's pretty because she does her hair and makeup very well. But she always has a sneer on her face, and that's why I don't think that she's a beauty queen. She has that sneer all the time on her face, and it makes her feel ugly. You know what I mean?
It gives her the.
I'm not judging her looks,
That is her character.
I'm not judging her looks, by the way. I'm just saying, yes, her character is all this sneer, and it makes her feel much worse than what she is. But yeah, Eva Bartok is a striking woman. She's not your classic like Marilyn Monroe kind of striking woman. More of, I don't know. She has the kind of smoky eyes, but she has a presence as well on screen.
I'm sure that if you got pictures of her later in life, she's still holding that
yes.
handsomeness, because it's...
Yes, I think so too. And I wish, well, now that I know who it is, I actually kind of want to see more movies that she's been in, because I think she was a very good actress in this. And I have a list. There's lots of movies that her career basically went from the 50s into the 60s. She didn't have a huge repertoire, let's put it that way. I only see 41 credits on Internet Movie Database. Okay, great. So we have those two main actors. There's other actors that appear in this movie that are pretty common in early British television and movies. There's one guy that played like the Sheriff of Nottingham for like 80 something episodes in the Robin Hood TV series back in the day. So there's people in here that have a pedigree. Okay. So we can get into the plot now. We can say there is some good actors. There's good, in front of the camera and behind the camera talent on this.
It starts with a rocket launch.
Yeah, it starts with a rocket launch. And of course, I know exactly what rocket launch that is. It's obviously a V2 test post-war. Almost every single science fiction movie in the early 1950s, when they want to have a rocket launch, they use stock footage from White Sands Missile Base firing off V2 rockets. There is stock footage in here of those V2 rocket launches from inside the rockets, where they had film shooting, down to watch the Earth kind of pulling away. There's that in this movie too. But we have this radio detector van that's racing up and down the road, and men jump out and go towards...
It's a lorry.
It's a radio detector van. They have like a big radio detector thing on the top that's spinning.
Down dirt roads.
And village roads.
And the credits are rolling.
Yeah. And some of these guys like jump out and they run towards some gear. And they end up going back to their base, which is called Deanfield Experimental Station. And we learn that like their lead researcher, scientist, engineer, whatever, is Dr. Mitchell, played by Howard Duff. And we learn that one of the mice that was on this rocket launch that they recovered died from extreme temperatures before they even go in.
Yeah. But there, I like the kind of,
is that Crenshaw? That's Crenshaw. Let's talk about it. Yeah.
I like the neat conversation that goes with the gate, guards.
And it sets Mitchell. Things up.
It goes, no blondes here.
Yeah, and then like they're smuggling girls in or
and
something.
And they opened up the back and Crenshaw goes, no blondes here either.
Yeah.
So there's this joke that's going on and it makes it more real.
Yeah, it does make it more real. It feels like they have this long-running joke with the guards, but it also is a piece of storytelling because it shows that the guards know exactly who these people are, what they were doing out there that was a mission, but they're still damn well going to check this van when it comes in because security's that tight. And this gets covered again and again through the movie. Okay, this is what's interesting. So they go back in, and it turns out that there's a general visiting from the U.S. And
is he from the U.S.?
Oh, yes, they say he's from the U.S.
Oh.
He even has like U.S. little markings on him. He has a U.S. flag.
Dr. Stephen Mitchell is from America, too.
Yes. And we're then introduced to the names of the people. Dr. Crenshaw is the biologist. Dr. Andrews is the fuel expert. And then Eva Bartok, playing Dr. Frank, comes in, and she's the mathematician.
But most everybody calls Dr. Andrews Toby.
Yeah.
Which is his first name. It's very rarely do they call him by his last or even doctor.
Yeah, it's just, oh, that's Toby. So, yeah, I think that's a little disrespectful. He is the youngest one on the team, but I still think that's kind of disrespectful. They do mostly refer to Dr. Frank as Dr. Frank. The only person that doesn't refer to Dr. Frank as Dr. Frank is
the professor,
who, because his title is professor, he's also the lead of the research team. Yeah, the director of this research team. He doesn't have a doctorate. If they're referring to him as professor, that's kind of like a honorary, like, hey, look, you can teach. You probably are actually very skilled. You're probably an expert in this field. But since you were the director, it's likely that you also got into administration of some sort and you never got your PhD. Otherwise, they would have called him doctor something.
Well, maybe he was professor and taught at a university.
But all these other people would have, too, at some point. Especially Crenshaw. As old as he is?
Yeah, but I'm like saying maybe he's still in that capacity.
I mean, maybe, but it just seems like it would be more respectful, especially to somebody that's in charge of this, to refer to them as doctor, in this case, rather than professor, if he had a PhD. I would actually refer to him as doctor, even if he didn't have a PhD, if he was in charge of this kind of project.
But maybe it's like Toby liking being called Toby instead of Dr.
But anyway,
Andrews.
They refer to Dr. Frank as Dr. Frank, except for the professor, who always says Lisa. And I thought that was interesting.
Until later. Because he actually treats her like his daughter.
Yeah, it doesn't seem right at first. It seems like he's talking down to her. But then, yeah, throughout the movie, you do get to realize that, yes, he is kind of seeing her as a daughter figure, that it's not talking down to her, that it's not disrespecting the fact that she does have a PhD.
She's a mathematician.
Yeah, she has a PhD in mathematics. It's not that he's disrespecting her. It's that he actually... they both feel close to each other and are on a first name basis. It just doesn't come across that way at first. Okay. I know I'm babbling about this, but this is the first time in a while that we have a movie where the woman is just as qualified as all the guys. And that's what I like about these early 50s movies. A lot of times you do have women that are just as qualified and on equal academic and
early 50s.
In early 50s, this happens quite often, but we haven't watched one of these movies in a while.
Yeah.
So I like pointing it out to say, hey, look, if you think the 1950s is all about scream queens and women just running from being menaced by monsters, no. There's guys that get menaced by monsters, girls that get menaced by monsters, but a lot of times in these early 50 movies, you do have an equality between the genders in a lot of ways. So we're shown this launch of the V2 rocket again, and they call it the launch of the Mark 7, and they're ready to proceed to the point of launching a satellite into orbit. So
what's called AS1.
AS1. Now they use diagrams and photographs from Rocket Ship XM to represent like the advanced rocket. I'm just saying that ahead of time. They're reusing special effects from another movie. But all this stuff is...
But there's a conversation in that one where they have the defense council in the room.
Yeah, and that's coming up.
Of starting... They're testing out these rockets so they can start a space station.
Yes, we'll get to it. We'll get to it because how they describe the launch path... especially since they're supposed to be launching from England, does not make sense at all. And I'll explain why in a bit. But there's a party to celebrate this last launch, this Mark 7 launch. And this is where we get some dynamics. This is where it sets up the rest of the movie, this party. So Dr. Mitchell is married to his wife, Vanessa. Vanessa is a terrible human being.
She married him for the status. Yes. He went and got into this program because that's what he wanted, really.
Okay,
and
yes.
Now she's stuck on a base that she can't leave.
And all she wants to do is live like the high life because my husband is a genius and can build all these different things. And now she can't. She's stuck on this base. Exactly. And she resents him for it. She resents him for it so much that she's cheating on him with Dr. Crenshaw, who is like twice her age. He's like in his 60s.
Yeah.
Like, and this is the thing. That throughout this movie, you realize that she's sleeping with him only as a means to an end. It's not that she actually loves him, even though she says that. It's because she just wants to have him get her off the base so she can go and like be a free woman, quote unquote. But yeah, they are sleeping together. This is like, there's a, and I guarantee you that Dr. Mitchell knows. And we, even before the next scene, because he does catch them necking off at his bungalow.
Kissing. Yeah. Off at Crenshaw's.
Yeah, at his bungalow. At Crenshaw's bungalow. But he doesn't look shocked at all. He's just like, oh, okay. And you're like, wait a second. Why is he having that reaction? The only thing that makes sense is that he has known forever. They have a loveless marriage at this point because he's not touching her.
They're sleeping in two different rooms.
Yeah, they're sleeping in two different rooms. And her, like, her attitude towards him is so awful.
Contemptuous.
Like, just, you can be making so much money. Look, I found this letter from this one organization.
That's her argument later.
That you could be making four times the amount of money that you make now. And he's like, but I signed on for this because this is progressing mankind. Okay. Now, I'm going to get a little tetchy about this because I'm a scientist. I can find a job most likely doing something I don't like doing with my intelligence and skills and make more money. I guarantee you I can. I do what I do. Not because of the money. I don't do climate change research because I'm wanting to make the big bucks. I'm wanting to do it because it benefits mankind. That it benefits the world. It gets people information out there that they can use to change things for the better, right?
I thought it was funny that in this argument, she accused him of having an affair with Lisa Frank.
And they aren't.
No.
They very clearly aren't.
But it probably made him think, go, oh.
That's where this is going to go.
You know, finally he goes, maybe she is looking at me. If Vanessa never pointed it out, I don't think he would have ever looked at Lisa in that way.
Do you know that Dr. Frank did not look at Mitchell at that party? That was Vanessa literally like doing transference, like trying to accuse somebody else, her husband, of cheating.
But there is a conversation.
Do you know who Frank glared at? Her. Frank glared at Vanessa because everyone knows that Vanessa was sleeping around.
Mm-hmm.
And Frank was like, Lisa Frank was like, I hate this woman. She's terrible.
There's later a conversation that Lisa has with the director that the director's like trying to get her to maybe leave the place because it's probably destroying her.
Yeah. But anyway, the director announces to the general that, at this party, the director announces that the general has approved the next big launch. And at this point, after all the different conversations, okay, this is where it becomes clear that Dr. Frank and Dr. Mitchell might be attracted to each other, but they haven't ever had any kind of feelings before. And we also have this conversation with Mrs. Mitchell, who got me, this got me upset, that she calls these research facilities a concentration camp. And I guarantee you, I guarantee you, that line was there. Well, yeah, I was like, F you, you know, guarantee you that line was there because this is too soon after the war for not, for people not to immediately have some sort of like gut reaction to that phrase. The reason I have the gut reaction is because, you know, I had family that died in concentration camps. So when somebody says that, I probably had the reaction that people had, more people, the general audience would have had at the time.
It was to get that kind of at
like, oh, reaction. This place is a concentration camp. Screw you, lady. So in the end, the rocket's ready to launch. It's a big multi-stage rocket. And this is where the director, the director and Lisa, Dr. Frank, describe the launch path of the vehicle. Okay, so you're launching from England, Darlene. So looking at a map in your mind, how would a launch path go with a rocket launching from England? Which direction should a rocket launch to get into orbit?
It should go towards Russia.
Yeah, okay. You're supposed to launch east because you're trying to use the momentum of the Earth's rotation to help get you into orbit. Okay? Now, the further from the equator that you are, the more energy you need to get into orbit. That's why you want launch facilities closest to the equator. Okay? But you can launch from really far north. That's fine.
That's why ours is in Cape...
Well, it's down in Florida. I mean, you can have places that are further south, but it's more difficult to get things there. I mean, that's why there's launch facilities for SpaceX in southern Texas, right on the Mexican border. Anyway, the way they describe the launch path is it will take off and go over the Atlantic Ocean. So it'll go west, where the first stage will drop off as it's going into orbit. So it's going to be working against the rotation of the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I said, okay, we're already bad science here. Unless you want to say that he thinks that, like, the North Sea is the Atlantic Ocean.
Well, I can say this. They might not want to launch it to go that way because if it crashes...
It'll go into the North Sea.
The North Sea is really disastrous.
Yeah, but it's better than going into, I don't know, Ireland?
I was just saying it's closer to the Iron Curtain.
Yeah, but, you know, if you're just launching a rocket up and you're, I don't know, if you don't even know if you have enough fuel to get into orbit properly, why are you going to work against the Earth's momentum?
I would be surprised. I would think that the... British would have used Australia.
Yeah, I mean, there's places in, like, the South Pacific that both, like, a lot of the EU, current EU nations and England used as launch facilities. But there's, like, this back and forth between the director and the general where the director is clearly all about, like, the science and exploration and progressing mankind and out to the planets, that this will allow us to build a space station. And the general's like, yes, we can keep an eye on everybody. And he's like, but we can go out to the stars. And then the general's like, no, but we can also drop nuclear weapons on anyone at any time. And it's like, you jackass. Like,
you have to pander to the person now.
Yeah. So we have this launch, and the launch goes wrong as the final stage, as it doesn't fire fully. Like, it seems to actually run out of fuel too soon. And instead of, like, orbiting at an altitude of 1,070-something miles, it ends up orbiting at 633 miles. And everyone's kind of looking at each other going, well, I guess it'll stay up there for decades, and technically this is a success. But everyone looks really down, you know, downtrodden by it, because all of their calculations said this thing should have gone up to, like, 1,070 miles. But... here's the problem. Dr. Crenshaw and Mrs. Mitchell have both disappeared. Bad news. And we have a Dr. Frank ends up coming in. And Dr. Frank is played by who?
Not Dr. Frank. It's Dr. Smith.
It's Dr. Smith. I guess I wrote down Dr.
What's his first name? I never knew.
I don't know. I guess I don't have it. Well, anyway, Dr. Smith. Yeah, he's the guy that comes in from London. And it turns out that he is a... What was his actual degree?
In biology.
Oh, yeah, because he's there to, like, replace Crenshaw. But it turns out that he's, like, working for MI5.
Yes.
He's working for, like, intelligence. And he's there to figure out what the hell happened to Crenshaw and Mitchell.
Not MI5. He's military intelligence. Because he also MI5. Has... Is that what it is?
Military Intelligence Department 5 would be okay. Internal security to England.
What do they have the for the military things?
I don't know. I'm just saying MI5, that military intelligence, I mean, Ministry of Intelligence, whatever. He's working for the intelligence, and I wrote down MI5. Because it's an internal matter, and I know MI5 works on internal matters to the UK.
I put military intelligence.
Okay, whatever.
Because that's what he calls himself.
Yeah, it's not Dr. Frank. I'm sorry. But
it's Dr. Smith. Dr.
Smith comes in, and he's there to replace Dr. Crenshaw. And then he asks Dr. Frank if it's possible that the fuel in the upper stage had been replaced with non-functional mass. And she's like, you're crazy. There's only one person that could have done that, and that would have been Dr. Mitchell.
And he wouldn't have done that.
And he wouldn't have done that because he was all about the success of this mission. Okay. So through a couple conversations, he ends up thinking that Dr. Mitchell may have done something to the rocket by killing Crenshaw and his wife and then putting their bodies aboard the rocket. And that it wasn't actually the rocket. Okay. So his logic here, and this is baffling, is that in order to fit the bodies aboard, he had to drain fuel out to put the bodies in. But we learn that that rocket that went up is a copy of the rocket we see later on that has this huge cockpit. And he wouldn't have had to drain fuel.
Yeah. I don't get that. You could fit
like 100 bodies in there.
The first thing I got to laugh at is he jumps to conclusions is one of the things, but the first thing you see that he's investigating is tries to leave the base.
Yeah, which is actually smart. He tries to leave the base, and we learned that these guards aren't just like, weren't just joking around with everybody at the beginning. They are actually really serious about their job. There is no way off the base except two gates. They're always guarded, and anyone that comes, they even record in a logbook like that you even attempted to leave. And there's super high fences with like razor wire. You cannot leave. So much so that this Dr. Smith is like, yeah, they did not leave this base.
Oh, here's what Smith was questioning the group in the professor's office. They would have had to have 3 gallons missing.
3 tons, Darlene. 3 tons of fuel missing.
Oh, 3 tons?
3 gallons. Come on. Okay, so...
The theory of murder... He thinks Crenshaw and Vanessa were stuffed into the rocket's third stage.
Yeah, so... No. Then Dr. Frank comes up with this idea that she thinks that she knows what may have happened, that they miscalculated, like, the friction coefficient on the exterior of the rocket. Okay, fair enough. And then, like, Frank and Mitchell kiss at this point in this scene. I know this, I'm not getting into all the little details because there's lots of little conversations in this movie that I did not write down.
Because there's Smith tells Mitchell that Crenshaw was a spy.
Frank says that she's always loved Mitchell. Mitchell tells the director that he'll go up to get the first rocket. Because if he's being accused of murder, he's going to go up there and prove by bringing back down the rocket that there's no bodies in it. Okay, so I'm like,
the professor refuses, and Dr. Smith.
Well, no, and then Mitchell basically says, "Who else would be able to? Who else would be good to do this mission?" And then Smith says, "You're right. I'll give you permission to do that." And I yelled at the screen, "Like, who else could be? Who else would be good to go on this mission? Literally anyone else."
Yes,
you're being accused of murder. Number one, if you're going up there to grapple with this rocket stage to bring it back down to show that there's no bodies,
you could have tampered with it.
You could tamper with it and go up there, pull the bodies out, and ditch them in orbit if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
You're literally like anybody else would be.
And besides that, you would not put the lead engineer.
Yes. On a mission that is likely not going to allow him to come back.
Yeah.
I mean, anyway, so they give him a permission, and then Dr. Frank tells Smith that Mitchell can't go alone. She tells Toby.
To ask
Smith to allow a second person to go, and you will volunteer. She says, you're going to volunteer, Toby. And he's like, oh, wait a second. I don't want to go. And she says, don't worry. You're not going to go. It's going to be me that goes. I'm just going to put on your spacesuit.
Yes.
Okay. Because the spacesuits actually have like these helmets.
She's the one that calculates stuff. I can see her getting away with that,
though. Yeah. So they end up getting ready to like go on this mission. Mitchell does not know that she's going to go. She says, I'm not going to let him go up there alone. I love him, etc.
And this is one of the complaints that Aaron had. At this point, things just sped up and went. It was slow.
It was slowly building, and then it just went. And the whole movie's done. And it's like, whoa, wait a second. All right, so Smith ends up just having another random conversation with the security guy. And it was about like how many like the security people that work on the base. And
you'd think he would have investigated this
is something very, very basic that he should have investigated right at the beginning. And it turns out that like everybody that's been working on this base for this project has been there for like 3 or 4 years, except one guy.
One security guard was changed, and it was changed because he had an accident the night before the launch.
No. It was one guy got hired on Crenshaw's recommendation.
Oh, I didn't get it because I thought there was an accident.
And so Smith, well, there was, because you're jumping ahead of scene. So Smith goes, oh my God, that's where they are. This security guard got them out. Because all the other security guards are like no-nonsense security guards. The fact that like this new guy came on.
Well, he shows the picture to the wife.
Yeah, he goes to the guy's house and shows the picture of Crenshaw to this security guard's wife.
And she goes, yes.
Yeah, I've seen him.
That's the person that he's got a boat with.
Yeah, he said he was talking about a boat, but her husband had died the night before in a car accident.
And named the place as Whittemere?
I don't know. So Smith is all freaking out and basically goes, oh my God, now I have to go out to this
Whittemere
boat place, and he's got cops with him at this point. And
it's coastal area.
Yeah, it's a coastal area. So he goes out there, and it turns out, yeah, Crenshaw and Mrs. Mitchell are there. And Mrs. Mitchell's like, you mean you want me to go to, where does he want to go? Like Germany?
I don't know. They never say, but
she says like 200 million people are there. And I'm like, okay, well, it's probably like either the U.S. or like mainland.
She
Europe.
Wanted to go to the U.S.
Okay, then it has to be like mainland Europe.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm not going to take you there. You can either come with me or you can stay here. And she's like, fine, I'll stay here. And he walks out but comes back in with a gun. And he says, well, I gave you a choice. And at this point, like Smith and the cops are running in. And they dive at Crenshaw right as he fires the gun. And he murders Mrs. Mitchell.
I always called her Vanessa in my notes. Because yeah. She wasn't really wife.
Yeah, she wasn't. No, because she treated everybody like shit. But anyway, she dies. Smith gets on the phone to say, hey, look, Mitchell doesn't have to go up there. You can call the launch. But all the phone lines have been cut for the launch for security purposes.
For security purposes.
And he's like, oh my God, crap, this is bad. I have to run out there now.
And Lisa changes place with Toby.
Yeah.
And Mitchell only finds out when they start to take off their gear.
Yeah, which is actually during the launch. But everyone, like, they don't know that anything has gone wrong until the rocket's in the air. And Smith can't get on the base fast enough. Like, as soon as he gets back to the base, the rocket's already in the air. So it's not like he can actually
stop it. Guards are sitting there watching it.
Yeah, it actually was nice. Like, there's
that's the, what do you do?
Yeah. So on the ship, like, the first stage cuts away, and then there's this... Was it the first stage? No, the first stage cuts away, and that's where they take off their helmets, and he kind of goes, oh my god, it's Lisa, you shouldn't have come. And she's like, you know, I don't want to be anywhere else. And then they're going to jettison the second stage, and that's when this, like, explosion happens?
No, I thought that was at the third stage.
They're on the third stage. So it's when the second stage is supposed to fall away, there's an explosion. And they're out of control. And everyone's kind of freaking out on the ground.
And she talks to the professor, the director.
And goes,
and tells him what went wrong.
Yeah, what went wrong. So it's likely exactly what went wrong with the first rocket.
I just have a squiggle because I didn't understand what the hell but she was saying.
It was basically the rocket goes out of control, but Mitchell's able to turn a valve that reroutes the fuel flow through the rocket and gets them so they'll actually come back to Earth, because the director's like, we know that you didn't kill anybody, you can come back. And they do. The end.
Yeah, it's the end. You don't even see them land or anything.
Yeah, it's just, it's the end. So, all right. Yes, I already said that this just goes breakneck in like the last 10 minutes.
Yeah, because all the other stuff is very slow. Like the fact that you have Crenshaw in the lab telling Toby that he was in the lab to get the keys. There was all kinds of clues that Crenshaw was doing stupid.
So what worked in this movie?
I think the mystery did.
The mystery was fine. Yeah, it was actually, it was entertaining for what it was. I thought the acting was good. I think the acting worked overall. I actually liked the actors in this.
I liked the outfits. They really seemed like they were for that era, for the
situation.
I would love to have that dress that Lisa was wearing
at the party. Yeah. What else worked in this movie?
Really? The actor that played Vanessa was really playing an ugly little person with a beautiful face.
Yeah. So give it to her. The acting and the mystery, fine. I think that's really it that works. Now, don't think that is a general...
The sets did.
The sets were okay. I can't say
they looked like they were something that was built for a few years.
Okay.
Okay, just like we built temporary barracks for World War II.
So don't think that me saying there's only a couple things that really work in this movie is a dig against it. Because what doesn't work in this movie? The pacing, I don't think, works. Because it feels fine all the way up until the end where it just goes insane. Comparatively speaking, you're like, okay, it's a nice mystery. We're kind of getting clues here, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know.
And it took Smith longer to get to the coast than it did to take him back.
I don't know. It was just a roundabout route. Maybe he was actually close back to the base as it was. But yeah, the pacing, I don't think really worked in this. But I can't really think of anything else that truly doesn't work about this movie. Can you?
No, I the only thing I can say is it's probably about a 6.
You think it's a, so you're going to recommend it?
I'm going to recommend it as if you like a mystery with a little bit of science flair to it.
Okay.
That it's kind of nice.
See, I would say this is pretty close to a 5, but I would also recommend it. It's a light recommendation. Like, so 5, I'll say 5.5. This is not a bad movie. It's, to be, if I'm gonna give it a damning statement, I'm gonna say a lot of it is forgettable. Because it's not really science fiction. It just has some rockets in it. It's a decent murder mystery, but I've seen better murder mysteries. It's Hammer, so you actually get some good direction and sets and costumes and
the writing. And camera work.
Yeah, and camera work. And that's all good. It's just, this is so early in Hammer's existence that they haven't really found what is Hammer yet, so to speak. But you can see some aspects starting to kind of bubble up into that. So I normally really enjoy Hammer films. Like I generally will go, oh, that's 6, 7 or whatever. But yeah, this is like a 5.5. I do recommend it. I think it's a nice little early 1950s murder mystery with some acting in it that is different in a good way. Like Dr. Frank, Eva Bartok, I think is a different kind of actress. I think she truly plays it as an intellectual, that she is kind of in love with this guy, but she's really trying to be there as a professional. And I respect that. I think she was probably the highlight of the movie.
I would rather be her talk to Toby. I'd rather be up there with him when he dies.
Yeah.
Than to live life without.
Yeah, without him. And I'm like, oh man, that's nice. That's nice. Is there anything else we want to say about this movie?
Not really.
Like, yeah, check it out. It's, like I said, an early Hammer film. So
if you like the early movies that were in the 50s that were drama, I think you'd really go. Or early, not your noir mysteries, but just the mysteries.
Yeah. So I'm Aaron.
I'm Darlene, and have a good evening.
Keep watching the skies.
At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought.
Thanks for listening to this episode of This Week in Geek. Hungry for more? Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net. You can subscribe to the podcast, browse our Twitter and Instagram, and leave your thoughts on today's topics. If you'd like to give us some feedback, send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. Tune in next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
We would be honored if you would join us.
Thank you for your cooperation. Good night.